Walter Mondale wins again. Pennsylvania's the latest, and he's passed the halfway mark in his race to be the Democratic candidate for the presidency. But there are still hurdles to come, especially the largest group of uncommitted voters. They're curiously called the Yuppies.
Campaigning for Senator Hart today. And the primary's on
obviously, that's
Tuesday.
What it says on your button.
That's right, take Hart, 84.
Yuppie is the word the Americans have coined for the unknown factor in their presidential election, the young urban professionals. They're 20% of the electorate, their vote can't be predicted, and even now they could still make Senator Gary Hart the presidential candidate for the Democrats. In the Democratic race, most of the larger eastern states have voted. Now the campaign moves to the center of America and the West. Walter Mondale has 1,047 committed delegates. Gary Hart has 571. Jesse Jackson has 152. And there are 331 uncommitted. So Mr. Mondale is well placed to get the 1,967 delegates needed to win. But it could be quite a fight, because the territory ahead, especially Texas and California, may well favor Hart, especially if Hart can continue to get the support of the Yuppies, the young urban professionals. This report by Denis, Tuohy.
Win, Jesse, win! 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 Win, Jesse, win!
There is no sure winner yet in the 1984 Democratic race, and no one will give way. In New York, they want Fritz, Walter Mondale, and they proved it in the primary. Two-thirds of the crucial Jewish vote went to the former vice president and now front-runner for the nomination. The only ethnic group he failed to win were the blacks, who voted overwhelmingly for Jesse Jackson. Ethnic support was boosted by the party establishment and explicit endorsements by the governor of the state and the mayor of the city. One of Mondale's strongest cards in New York and in Pennsylvania this week has been the union vote. The AFL-CIO, America's equivalent of the British TUC, have backed him as their candidate. And in meetings like this, the message is made clear to shop stewards and other union officials to get the vote out for the man who's on their side.
Whether it's the issue of fair trade, domestic content, Hart's wrong and Mondale's right. Question of minimum wage or sub-minimum wage for teenagers, where you would have fast food places paying less than the minimum wage for teenagers and in other places throughout our community. The effect of that, simple. You fire the father and you hire the son because it's cheaper. Mondale's right on that issue and Hart is wrong on that issue. Windfall profits tax, Hart's wrong, Mondale's right. OSHA, safety in the workplace, Mondale is right, Hart is wrong.
Outside a school for apprentices in Lower Manhattan, union canvassers spread the word for Walter Mondale.
Brother, you guys coming out and voting tomorrow? You guys registered?
Mondale's record with coming the unions is solid. He has supported government intervention to save industries in trouble, and he argues for restricting foreign imports to protect jobs and pay packets. In general, Mondale's attitude to the unions shines the brighter for their mistrust of Ronald Reagan.
I don't think that really Walter Mondale wants to change our wages, whereas Reagan, President Reagan right now, he's voted into some real anti-union legislation that, you know, it's gonna hurt us along the line. So, you know, if we do get our candidate in Walter Mondale, and he thinks more or less on the same lines as us, then, you know, it's nice to have someone in the White House that you can sit down and talk with and not just, as Reagan does, turn his back on labor.
In a wider sense, Walter Mondale fits the traditional image of the Democratic Party as the party that cares. A hospital in New York's East Harlem district. Mondale's commitment to more funds for social welfare and less for defense is matched by both Hart and Jackson. But what he adds is the impression of solid dependability. The first question is about daycare centers for the children of working mothers.
Many behind me at least know, for many, many years in the Senate, I was the one who fought for daycare. I led the fight, I maintained the efforts.
Vice President Mondale, I have a son. He'll be 18 years old in August, and I'd like to know, how do you feel about this draft? He is college bound. I would like to know about his education. Will he be stopped in the middle of his education?
It's a matter of having a president who knows what he's doing and a president who stands for sensible policies like the fact that we don't need a draft. I voted, helped lead the fight for a voluntary system of military service nearly a decade ago. It's worked well. It's worked better than many of us expected. There's no need to change. Finally, your son ought to have a chance to go on to college. There ought to be a loan there for him. He ought to have a chance for work study and the rest if he wants it. And I strongly support those efforts.
At the start of the year, Mondale was the predestined winner of the Democratic nomination, so the campaign money flowed his way. Hart has had to match his own primary successes with funds to keep him running. His wife, Lee, is guest of honor at this fundraising cocktail party in New York. And what's attracting the money is the style and vigor of the senator who got in the way of the Democrats' foregone conclusion.
Thank you very much. Thank you. We will not be a nation that each of us as Americans can be proud of so long as this president remains in the White House, because he has warped this nation's priorities. He has taken from those who need our help the most, the poor, the elderly, the young, the disabled, the disadvantaged, the unemployed, the homeless, and he has put our national treasure into building nuclear weapon systems that make the world more dangerous. The people of this state and the people of this nation have a clear choice. We can go backward to the leadership of this party's past, to the established arrangements and the established agendas and the policies of the 60s and 70s. Or we can move forward with bold new leadership that addresses the new challenges of our time. And with your help, I intend to be that leader and the nominee of our party and the next president of the United States. Thank you very much.
That the senator from Colorado can credibly voice that ambition is, for American political experts, the favorite subject for speculation in this election year.
I think the appeal of Gary Hart is, well, if you'll pardon the academic political scientist, you know, talking in classroom terms, what we generally say is that with a candidate like Hart, people who are drawn to him do not ask too many detailed questions about what he stands for, what his background is, because there's the general appeal of Gary Hart, and therefore what you do is you project onto Gary Hart your idea of what you'd like Gary Hart to be. And the great good fortune of Gary Hart, at least at this stage, is that he can accept these projections. They stick onto him. So out there is, you know, the Gary Hart that individuals want to see. The same thing happened with John Kennedy. And this, I think, is really the basis of his popularity. He exudes youth, progressive, forward-looking, a new look at government, a new look at the country, and all this is what, you know, just beautiful for the yuppie. They say, that's my person.
It's new and not so new, this newness of Gary Hart. Not new in that every politician in a democracy in search of power must talk of tomorrow, must promise a tomorrow that is different, and therefore new. In principle, nothing new about that. What is new, though, about the Hart campaign, or new at least since John Kennedy a quarter of a century ago, is the buzz, the turn-on that it can generate. For a fair percentage of Americans, how fair that is, time will tell, Hart is a mirror, showing them themselves as they think they are or want to be, talking to them in what they feel is a common language.
Kennedy was the first president who excited them. They were just small kids at the time. Then they and Martin Luther King got them excited, then Bobby Kennedy got them excited. All three were wiped out. All three were assassinated. This was an early trauma that they had. As a group, they've now begun to make it. They now are breeding their children, raising their children. They've become tax-paying citizens. And as such, one would think they're part of the establishment, but they're not. That's the key. They feel, by and large, shut out. And they do work, say, for corporations, largely. But their allegiance isn't to the corporation. Their allegiance is basically to two other things. It's to themselves in terms of their own lifestyles and aspirations, and it's to their professions.
Rochester, in New York State, is Yuppie territory, a major center for the high technology professions of computer science. This is a world that has little to do with roots or heritage and everything to do with here and now. In homes like these live the so-called upwardly mobile white-collar workers that Hart has been winning. But as Hart campaigners have discovered, the Yuppie commitment is often one that comes late as the polling booth. On the doorstep, many of them offer little other than courtesy and a willingness to consider the options.
Hi, Mrs. Leone, how are you?
Good.
Good.
What are you selling?
Mary Beth and I, we're not selling anything.
Hi,
votes.
Mary.
We're out campaigning for Senator Hart. We're going to put Ronald Reagan out of the White House.
Right, that's what they're all doing at work. I got a thing from the union, too, telling me that.
Yeah, who are they telling you to vote for?
Mondale.
Well, we're telling you to vote for Hart.
They're telling you to go with Mondale.
we'll help you support Hart.
Okay.
All right?
Yeah, if he's for me, I'll support him. Yeah.
Well, I think he's a good man.
Okay?
Right. We'll see you later. Bye-bye now. Hi, Mr. Shout. How are you?
Good. Yeah, how about you, Joe?
Good. Very good. I'm out campaigning today for Senator Hart. The primary's on Tuesday, and we're asking people whether or not they plan on supporting Senator Hart. What do you think of him?
Well, I watched the debate the other night.
Yeah.
Okay. And I was kind of disappointed again with all the Democrats.
Oh, really? That's not a good sign.
No. I'm going to support one of them. I'm not sure which one at this point.
Okay.
But I was, a bit surprised. I would like to see a little more of Hart's views as to exactly what he is trying to pursue, because he changed his mind from one minute to the next.
That concern still haunts the Hart campaign and Hart campaigners. A need to know more of the substance that goes with style.
Well, tonight, I think we're starting to show where the beef is in this campaign. What we're talking about here in New York between now and next Tuesday is the only question that counts, and that is who would make the best president of the United States. That's the only question. And tonight we had a chance to really go into some of those issues that bear on our future. The most important question of our time. We got a lot of young people here tonight. Yuppies, I think you're called. They're here tonight.
Mark Siegel, a New York campaign manager for Gary Hart, and his wife Nancy are self-confessed yuppies and deeply committed to being so.
Well, this whole business of new ideas, Mondale, of course, has made a big joke of it. Like, where's the beef? But to us, it isn't a joke. To us, this really is someone who's new and different and doesn't represent the old politics and the old arrangements. And, of course, Gary Hart, this is his message, which people have bought throughout.
Yuppie's sort of a put-down term, but the fact is that there is something different in terms of families where both people work, where both people went to college, where both people feel that they have an opportunity to change the world. That would be lost if Mondale was nominated, because he represents the same people who have been putting us down since the mid-60s. That's a tremendous, tremendous difference.
Okay. Mark and Nancy Siegel are classic representatives of a 1984 voting phenomenon. The New York Times, no less, has called this the year of the Yuppie. Pollsters reckon there are well over 30 million of them in cities and suburbs across the United States. In the Democratic primaries, it's Gary Hart who's been drawing them to the mechanized polling booths. But where traditional party organization is strong, their votes for Hart could not overcome Walter Mondale's heritage. Indeed, in New York, their candidate only just edged into third place the other phenomenon of this campaign, Jesse Jackson.
That's not a scientific poll. That's a soul poll. But it will be scientific on Tuesday when you vote. Mr. Hart is so far removed from the poor, he thinks the poor are poor because they don't have ideas. Poor folks got more ideas than anybody. Necessity. Necessity is the mother of invention. Mr. Mondale thinks they need aid. Poor folks don't need ideas, they need a chance. They don't need aid, they need trade. That is a way out. A way out. If Mr. Hart wants some ideas, he should stop by my mama's house in Greenville. Problem is, mama got more ideas than she got rooms.
This is really marvelous to behold because what is, you know, it's been mobilization of people here, black Americans, solely on racial grounds. In fact, there's a bit of an analogy because the black voter is supporting Jackson simply, not just because he's black, but because they are projecting onto Jackson. He is our man. You know? And they're not asking questions about his background or about his, talents as a financial administrator, anything like that. And it's, of course, for black voters, it's more than a matter of style. It's a matter of really saying, hey, do I have a future in this country?
It is now more than likely that black voters will have a say in how the Democratic nomination goes. Jesse Jackson is on the way to winning enough delegates to the convention in San Francisco in July to be a power broker in terms of party choice and party policy. There is even talk of Jackson himself as the nominee for vice president. But while the Democrats proceed with their internal contest, they've not forgotten who the ultimate opponent will be in November. And as far as that goes, it's clear that the gloves are off. Vote Democratic, but for whom? At Gary Hart's headquarters in New York last week, they waited for good news that was not to come. But if there is one rule in politics, it is that defeat must be faced with bravado. So it was at Hart headquarters.
Ladies and gentlemen, the next president of the United States, Gary Hart.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you. I still love New York. And New York is going to love us a lot more next fall when we get to know each other better. This campaign, it goes on to Nebraska, to Oregon, to Texas, and to California. And with your help, it goes on to San Francisco and on to the White House.
There is no doubt that Hart has been bruised by his defeats in New York last week and Pennsylvania 2 days ago. But according to the pollsters, the man he's trying to overtake, Walter Mondale, has one major liability.
In general, American politicians, because of the different electoral system here, and indeed the American public, are much more concerned not just about electing the man or woman who they want to be a candidate, but the candidate who can win. and they will frequently support a candidate even though he's not the preferred choice if they think he's the likely winner. Right now, Mondale has not convinced people that he's a likely winner against Reagan, and that is very damaging to him.
And Hart still has that possibility in people's minds.
Hart is perceived both by sophologists and pundits such as ourselves who look at the data as having a much better chance of winning the center vote, winning the independent vote and the moderate Republican vote than Mondale. And the American public, who are often pretty smart in these things, share those views.
The young urban professionals, the yuppies, certainly share those views, and they are 20% of the electorate. In New York and Pennsylvania, their votes were not enough to offset what the unions and traditional party leadership could deliver for Walter Mondale. Gary Hart believes it will be different in the South and West, in key states like Texas and California. Meanwhile, for all three Democratic candidates, the beat goes on.